Greetings and welcome to Ill Repute, a podcast about women and women first. I'm Sovereign Syre, a writer, a comedian, and a person with a pit bull rescue. And yes, that is my whole personality.
And I'm Ella Darling, a former librarian, a VR entrepreneur, and a tall drink of water.
Yes, yes, you are.
Yes. Now, we here at Ill Repute support women's rights.
But more importantly, we support women's wrongs.
And which women's wrongs are we righting today, Sovereign?
Today, we are talking about the most beautiful suicide, which is the name of a very famous photograph of a woman after she jumped to her death from the Empire State Building.
So, as our listeners can already surmise, this episode is going to be... We're going to discuss incidents of completed suicide. We're going to give context to better understand the decisions and the depictions and the whole scope of female suffering and what it tells us about our culture, about ourselves. But ultimately, the biggest thing that you should know right now, if you're listening to this, is that we will be discussing topics surrounding and directly involving suicide. If this is not something that you feel like you have the capacity to handle, we totally feel that we get you. Please take care of
Absolutely.
Yourself.
If you think you might be triggered by today's content, feel free to skip this episode. No podcast is worth your well-being. We are putting resources in the show notes if you find yourself needing to reach out for help.
Today's episode is going to analyze three different iconic depictions of female suicide. They have had substantial impacts on the culture and our understanding of female suicide. The following pieces of art have heavily influenced our narratives around women and their suffering. Part one.
Elizabeth Siddal, The Tragedy of Art's Greatest Supermodel. So the first artwork we're going to look at is the iconic painting Ophelia by Sir John Everett Millais. Ophelia is one of the most famous and evocative works of art from the 19th century. You may think you know nothing about art, but chances are you've seen the image of a beautiful young woman lying on her back in a river, dressed in a silver gown, her long red hair floating around her head and body, a vacant look in her eyes as they look up towards the heavens. Created in 1851, it was inspired by William Shakespeare's character Ophelia from the play Hamlet.
In the play, a Danish prince, Hamlet, is away at school when his father is killed. Before his father is in the ground, his mother has married Hamlet's uncle, and Hamlet returns home to find out the exact nature of the intrigue that led to his father's assassination. Hamlet had also left behind Ophelia, a young noble woman set to be his bride. When he left, the two were in love.
However, when Hamlet arrives, his only occupation is vindicating his father and eradicating the palace of traitors. He rebuffs Ophelia and feigns madness as though he doesn't remember their love. As the play progresses, Ophelia is slowly driven mad by Hamlet's rejection until ultimately she completes suicide by drowning herself in a river.
In his painting, Millais captures the tragic moment of Ophelia's death. The scene depicts Ophelia floating in a stream. She appears in a serene and peaceful posture, floating on her back, surrounded by flowers and greenery. The representation of Ophelia's death, often romanticized and idealized, echoes the societal tendency to view female suffering through a lens of fragile beauty and tragic innocence.
Ophelia is arguably one of the most recognizable paintings from the period, and what made it so popular was the fate of the model who posed for it. Elizabeth Siddal was perhaps the most significant of the female models who posed for the pre-Raphaelite Brotherhood. Their ideas of female beauty were fundamentally influenced and personified by her. And when she took her own life a few years after Ophelia was completed, the tragic coincidence propelled the painting into the artistic canon.
However, the life and death of Elizabeth Siddal bore very little resemblance to that of Ophelia. Ophelia was a young noblewoman destined to marry a prince. Ophelia, naive and preoccupied only with her romance with Hamlet, Elizabeth Siddal, however, came from a working class background. She worked as a shop girl in a millinery in London, and far from being innocent, her modeling was considered pretty much akin to sex work at the time.
Yeah. So back in the day, modeling and acting, when women did them, were generally considered pretty much sex work. There was this assumption that being on stage or being painted was in effect an advertisement. In the show notes, which will be posted on the Patreon after this episode goes live, there are some photos of Elizabeth. She was called Lizzie, and some of the artwork of her and that she has done. The following is from an article called The Tragedy of Art's Greatest Supermodel. And again, sources will be linked in the notes. Quote, in the winter of 1849 to 1850, the artists Dante Gabriel Rossetti and William Holman Hunt were painting together when their friend, Walter Howell Deverell, burst into the studio. The visitor announced excitedly, "You fellows can't tell what a stupendously beautiful creature I have found. She's like a queen, magnificently tall." With these words, the unlikely beauty of Elizabeth Siddal began to make history, unquote.
The artists, along with John Millais, were part of a secret society of seven artists that they called the Pre-Raphaelite Brotherhood, as you mentioned. This group of men also included writers, other artists, and female models. Siddal worked long hours in rough conditions and had ill health, so it's not surprising that her mother allowed her to become an artist model. There's similar to artist models today and just models and cam girls today. Modeling is actually quite an accessible career if you are somebody who has, you know, a physical disability or immune disorder.
Yeah.
Walter Deverell pulled out all the stops, sending his own mother in a grand carriage to Siddal's house to ask her mother permission to pay for the honor of painting Elizabeth. Again, from The Tragedy of Art's Greatest Supermodel.
Quote, although today Lizzie Siddal's willowy build, gaunt features, and lustrous copper-colored hair were considered signs of beauty, in the 1850s, being very thin was not considered sexually attractive, and red hair was described by one female journalist as, quote-unquote, social suicide. Through her modeling work and the success of the paintings she appeared in, Lizzie helped change the public opinion of beauty, unquote.
Paintings of her stud the memories of my youth.
Yeah, like once I got into it, I was like, oh my God, all of these images are super iconic. These are the redheaded woman that you see on posters and other framed prints, usually in like massage houses or hairdressers places or any place that women kind of congregate. These prints would be on the walls,
oh, yeah,
adorning the walls. Your English teacher's classroom, they marked a Victorian period and like very emblematic of the ideal of female beauty.
Dante Gabriel Rossetti met Siddal in 1849. Rossetti gave Siddal the nickname Lizzie when she entered the Pre-Raphaelite Brotherhood circle. The diminutive Lizzie enhanced her youthful dependent role. By 1851 or 1852, they became engaged. Siddal had also become Rossetti's main model and muse, and he stopped her from modeling for others.
If there was a script for The Suitcase Pimp.
Yeah, he's following it to a T.
Yeah, yeah. And for those that don't know, Suitcase Pimp is the person that goes with an adult model to shoots and like gets her Starbucks and carries her bags and lives with her and all of the things and is like basically completely dependent on her income.
With the grandiose hopes that his dick might eventually appear on camera adjacent to her.
Yeah, exactly. In 1852, Siddal began to study with Rossetti. During this period, Rossetti's most abundant and personal works were his pencil sketches of Siddal at home, most of which he entitled simply Elizabeth Siddal. It has been estimated that there are thousands of Rossetti's drawings, paintings, and poems in which Siddal was a subject.
He told his friend Ford Madox Brown that her fecundity of invention and facility are quite wonderful, much greater than mine. Siddal seems to have inspired Rossetti, as he followed her in depicting the same subjects, and he reused her designs after her death. Siddal's self-portraits diverged from the pre-Raphaelite's typical idealized beauty. As Anna Solomon wrote, she depicts herself looking harsher, angrier, and less attractive than the languid Siddal of the pre-Raphaelite paintings.
As Siddal came from a working-class family, Rossetti feared introducing her to his family. Siddal was the victim of harsh criticism from his sisters. The knowledge that his family would not approve contributed to Rossetti delaying the marriage. Siddal appears to have believed, with some justification, that Rossetti was always seeking to replace her with a younger muse, which contributed to her later depressive periods and illness.
Although Ruskin urged Rossetti to marry in 1855, their relationship deteriorated. The reasons probably included Siddal's ill health, her laudanum addiction, Rossetti's philandering, his lack of funds, the aforementioned disapproval of Rossetti's family, and Rossetti's probable aversion to marriage in general. He does seem like that kind of fucking guy.
I mean, haven't we all been there where you're the muse of a photographer and you get to watch nightly as he scrolls through Instagram looking for who's going to be
your replacement
while sitting on the couch you paid for and the bed you paid for and the apartment you're paying for.
Yes.
Yeah.
And resenting you because why are you like this? This girl he's about to find, I'm sure, will be someone better.
From the tragedy of art's greatest supermodel. Quote, in 1854, Siddal's career as an artist began. Rossetti was teaching her, and when Ruskin saw her work, he proclaimed her a genius. Her paintings were often derided by art critics, yet Siddal had only just begun learning, whereas the men of her circle had been honing their craft under expert tutelage for many years. Her surprisingly quick progress shows why Ruskin took such an interest in her. He gave her an annual salary of £150 to enable her to paint. In her full-time job at the hat shop, she had earned £24 a year. So he basically, six times her income?
Wow. In 1857, she was the sole female exhibitor at the pre-Raphaelite exhibition in London, where one of her paintings, Clerk Saunders from 1857, was bought by an influential U.S. collector, Charles Elliot Norton. Shortly afterwards, Siddal, whose health and relationship had been worsening for some time, gave up her annuity from Ruskin. Now, what exactly does that
mean? He was sponsoring her. So that £150 a year, she gave that up.
And she just didn't have that money, or did that take away any other ability of hers or opportunity?
So Rossetti and Ruskin had been controlling her life, and she wanted to escape. Using her savings, she took one of her sisters to the spa town of Matlock in Derbyshire. Then, instead of returning to London, she traveled to Sheffield, her father's birthplace, to stay with her cousins. Siddal soon moved into a lodging house and enrolled at the Sheffield School of Art, determined to make it as an artist on her own.
In spring of 1860, Siddal's family contacted Ruskin with the news that Siddal was gravely ill. Ruskin, in turn, informed Rossetti. Siddal was at the seaside resort of Hastings. In a change of heart, Rossetti hurried to her side that April with a marriage license.
Siddal and Rossetti married on Wednesday, May 23rd, 1860, at St. Clement's Church in Hastings. When Siddal's health improved, they honeymooned in Paris and Boulogne in the latter half of 1860, then returned to Chatham Palace residence that they expanded into an adjoining house. Siddal became pregnant and appeared to be happier and healthier.
It was thought that she suffered from tuberculosis, but some historians believe that there was an intestinal disorder that was more likely. Albert Hubbard wrote that she suffered much from neuralgia, and the laudanum taken to relieve the pain of that had grown into a necessity. So she got addicted to the laudanum that she was taking to treat her neuralgia.
Yeah.
Others suggest that she may have been anorexic, or that her poor health was due to laudanum addiction, or a combination of ailments.
Right. And I mean, it can kind of be that thing. You start taking the pain pills because of a real thing. Mm-hmm. And then the addiction to the pain pills creates more illness.
Manifestation.
So Yeah. Siddal traveled to Paris and Nice for several years for her health. At the time of her wedding, she was so frail and ill that she had to be carried to the church, despite it being a 5-minute walk from where she was staying. She became severely depressed, and her long illness gave her access to laudanum, to which she became addicted. By 1861, Siddal became pregnant, which ended with the birth of a stillborn daughter. The stillbirth left Siddal with postpartum depression.
Again, from the Tragedy of Art's Greatest Supermodel, quote, "On the evening of February 10th, 1862, the Rossettis went out to dinner with the poet Algernon Charles Swinburne. After they returned home, Rossetti went to teach a night class at the Working Men's College. Before he left, he saw Lizzie settled into bed. She had taken her usual dose of laudanum and there was about half a bottle left. When he returned from work, the bottle was empty. Lizzie was in a sleep so deep he was unable to wake her, and she had written him a note. Yelling for their landlady to fetch a doctor, Rossetti hid the incriminating letter."
Despite the efforts of four doctors, Lizzie Rossetti died in the early hours of February 11th, 1862. On the advice of their friend, Ford Maddox Brown, Rossetti burned her suicide note. This was to ensure she was not declared a suicide and so denied a Christian burial. At the time of her death, Lizzie was pregnant again. She was 32 years old.
And you've included what kind of photograph is this?
A daguerreotype?
Yeah.
Daguerreotype? Yeah. There was also that picture at the top, the black and white photo of her.
Yeah, there's an incredible photo of her fully buttoned up in a black gown that goes all the way to her ankles, all the way to her wrists, sterile buttons all the way up her chest. And it looks like something you'd see in a young woman's institution.
It's really interesting to me, you know, what kind of cemented the Ophelia painting in the canon was about 8 years after it was completed, the model killed herself by overdosing on opium, and like the opium poppies were in the painting, mm-hmm. like around her, mm-hmm. because in the Victorian era, they used a lot of symbolism. So the flowers that he chose to paint into the water around her were all symbolic. They all had meanings that were well known by people, right? And it's like, so she's painted as a woman who's just committed suicide, surrounded by basically opium like poppies,
the tools of her demise.
And yeah, and then she goes on to overdose and take her own life. And what's interesting is that the romanticization of her death, and that it's encapsulated in this picture of Ophelia, which is so vastly different from like what was going on in her life. You know, she had a philandering husband. She was very ill. She was trying so hard to establish herself as an artist and like really couldn't get out from under the shadow of her husband. And her patron, you know, was paying for her, but that meant she was also beholden to him. And so it's the actual circumstances of her death are pretty horrible. Mm-hmm. You know, like she's got a philandering husband. She's in super ill health. She's struggling to make a living. She can't get artistic recognition for the work she is doing. She's just had a stillborn child. And I just don't feel like there was like the support for her.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think that it just wasn't there. It just seems incredibly lonely.
Yeah.
And like a frustrating way to live, where you're just completely dependent on the men around you, and you know their investment in you is an investment in a fantasy of who you are.
When you're devoid of agency, all you have to go on is how you can inspire others around you to care enough to help you survive, and that must be fucking exhausting. That really goes towards the excellent quote that you had several episodes ago, that if you marry for money, you'll work every day for the rest of your life.
Yeah.
That's very much the trap that I think she fell into here.
Yeah.
Also,
like, what were her options, right? She's like working class. So it's like work in a dress shop. There wasn't a lot of social mobility going on, you know, mm-hmm. or engage in this lifestyle that is viewed by the outside world as kind of akin to sex work, because it's known, they used to call them lotus eaters, because everyone knew that all these people were addicted to opium, mm-hmm. and having free love orgies and shit like that. Like the lifestyle was associated with you know, the bottom dregs of society, when ironically the ones engaging in it were the ones that could afford to, that were actually super upper class. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it's like in order to escape class and to be able to support herself, she had to, she, you know, marries this guy, and like, and it's a miserable marriage.
And so, depictions of her are already romanticized. So the end of her story is sort of pre-romanticized before we even read it. We've already got these incredible like depictions of feminine beauty that will live through the ages. And it just happens that the story of that beauty ends at her own hands.
And that's what I was wanting to get to with this. That's why I picked three different kind of iconic examples about how this happens over and over again, which it's like, it's not just a quirk. It's not a bug, it's a feature. And it has to do with, you know, how we romanticize and fetishize female suffering.
Yes. And this is something that I'm sure we'll get to, but there's an epidemiological nature to suicide where once you're exposed to it, like once a suicide happens, let's say like in a high school district, the likelihood of further suicidality incidents occurring amongst that student base increases significantly.
Yeah. Well, it's called social contagion.
Social contagion. Right?
There's a valid argument for that.
Yeah.
So this brings us to our second piece of art. And so this is part two, The Unknown Woman of the Seine. 30 years after the debut of John Millais' painting Ophelia, and 20 years after the death of Elizabeth Siddal, another woman's suicide would become synonymous with the anonymity of the big city. From the article, How the Unknown Woman of the Seine Became Rissussi Annie.
Quote, "The body of a young woman, presumed to be no more than 16 years old, is pulled out of the River Seine. As is customary, her body is displayed in the mortuary window on a marble slab, which was a popular attraction at the time, in the hope that a family will come forward to claim her. They don't."
The article goes on. "Her body shows no sign of disease or trauma. Suicide is suspected. But something else intrigues the pathologist. Her face, upon which is a calm, knowing, half-smile, quite unlike anything you'd expect from a person drowning. The pathologist was so taken by her, he ordered a plaster cast be made of her face." Unquote.
Which is appalling that could happen.
It was very common back then because they photography, developing labs, like all of that stuff. It was very common.
There's actually no oversight. There's no.
But it's not about that. It's like you would take a plaster cast before decomposition set in, mm-hmm. so that they might potentially be identified later. So what I'm saying is taking a death mask of an unknown person was common.
And it, because so it was like altruistic.
It was part of their forensic technology that they had available.
Okay.
They can make a plaster cast at death. They can put you on ice and put you on display in the window on the street. They didn't have fingerprints. They didn't have DNA. They didn't have any of that shit. So if an unknown person came in, they were very limited. You had a very short window of time that you could show the body to people and say, "Do you recognize this person?" And one way they could prolong that identification process would be to make a plaster death mask that they could then put on display. You could go look at the death masks and maybe you recognize the plaster cast of their face after their body's already decomped. So this wasn't as weird or macabre as it sounds.
Okay, that's helpful. That's really helpful right. insight. Because at face yeah. value in the year of our Lord 2024, it sounds like a huge privacy invasion. But when you really consider everything that you just described, it's like, no, this is what you kind of had to do if you ever wanted a conclusion.
They did have photographs, but it was like taking a photograph of the dead body was considered more macabre. It was kind of like a death mask was a little more pleasant. And that was still an issue even with like the Black Dahlia, the boy in the box, like figuring out like how to display a face of a dead person in a photograph was kind of, it was hard.
It still is today.
Yeah. But today you would go pull their driver's license photo. You would have other records that you could like compare things to. We all do a thumbprint for our driver's license these days and have for like decades. So like there's still like more ways they can find like photos.
Yeah.
Like, so they don't have to do that. it today with DNA testing, everything else, if you really wanted to know the identity of a deceased person, you could. Yeah. I mean, they're not going to pull out all those stops for our unhoused neighbors. They're not going to pull out those stops for victims they don't think are special. But even then, they will take, so every year, the LA coroner's office goes out and goes through all of our unhoused neighbors' sites and collects deceased bodies. And they collect the dead. They take their fingerprints. They take DNA scrapings, like under the fingernails, hair. And then it gets filed away. And they will do like a fingerprint check to see if they can just get an ID that way. Yeah. If that doesn't, whatever, they just store away that DNA. And then it's like if it gets loaded into CODIS or whatever else, and you know, filed away somewhere, you know, but like these days, that's more how it's done. And you have to also remember, like, coroners were not doctors. Coroners were just elected officials. They were just appointed to the position and they would just go in and be like, looks like a suicide. I mean, that's how it was done. And a lot of people do not appreciate this. So at this time, like forensic science is not even like a thing yet. Mm-hmm. You know, there weren't a lot of tools available to investigators at this time. And we'll do one on one of the women, the woman that actually birthed forensic science as its own study and created the first forensic college at Harvard.
Yes.
We'll get into her at a later date, but it was a woman that did that. But because she was like, hey, we should maybe make this a science with rules and teach people how to do investigations, and maybe coroners should require that they have some kind of medical, you know,
they should,
expertise. Yeah. These things weren't streamlined yet. Parameters yet. There wasn't a rule book. There weren't standards and practices. Now this is where it does get weird. So he's got the death mask, right? And then he was showing it to people, and people wanted it because she was so beautiful. So
of course she was. What did he do? What did he do? What did this man do? So this death mask was cast and reproduced, creating an image that seemed to encapsulate a sense of tranquil repose. The death mask gained attention beyond forensic purposes and became an object of fascination in artistic and cultural circles. Casts of her beautiful face were sold everywhere. Intellectuals kept them in their houses. The look on the woman's face, the details of her eyebrows and eyelashes, the expression of serenity on her face, captivated people. Her face came to be seen as the embodiment of perfect feminine beauty. Let's take a fucking second to reflect on the fact that perfect feminine beauty means you are so exhausted at your own existence that you take your life at your own hand.
Yeah.
The apex of beauty is literally kill yourself, bitch.
That is correct. But so if you're really interested in this, there's a podcast called Criminal. I love it. It's the best voice in the history of podcasting. It's Phoebe Judge. But they do a piece on the unknown woman that... and it's linked in the show notes, that episode. But she goes into, this really was kind of a piece of pop culture. Like if you were an artist or a bohemian, like you had this death mask like on your wall. It was sort of a nudge, like nod to like, I'm a poet. I'm culturally into
early the scene. Early Che Guevara.
Yeah. I mean, but really, like, it, you know, it was for like, you know, what would probably become goths, you know, and, you know, the way that people have things with pictures of Marilyn Monroe where she looks sad, and that becomes it becomes a social and cultural statement, you know, and that's kind of what happened to this death mask. It just became. And part of it was because it was steeped in mystery, right? Because no one ever identified her, right? So she was unclaimed. And I think that was also a big part of the allure of the story, was here's this beautiful young girl and like no one's claiming her. Like someone must be missing her, but they're not. And so I think that also tied into fears and anxieties about the city, you know, and the anonymity of the city and how it was particularly perniciously dangerous for all the young women that were starting to flood into the cities to work in factories and to take on that more independent labor.
That makes a lot of sense. Like couching it in that rhetoric makes a lot of sense.
Yeah. So while the true story of the woman's circumstances was never known, it didn't keep narratives about her from being built out. The most popular being that she'd been jilted or rejected by a lover and threw herself into the river. Some added that she was pregnant. Her beauty was a blank canvas for the public to project its own narrative onto. And as I said before, at this time, as cities were crowded with people, the anonymity of a bustling metropolis and its attendant dangers for young, innocent girls was a subject of intense fascination.
Again, from How the Unknown Woman of the Seine Became Recessa Annie. Quote, in 1926, the death mask was included in a catalog of death masks and was titled, Sav, could you take that for me?
L'Inconnu de la Seine.
L'Inconnu de la Seine. De la Seine.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Which is the unknown woman of the Seine. And her legend was complete. And I'll just describe the image that you've provided. It is of a, it looks like a plaster cast of a woman who looks like she's got very fine bone structure, big eyes, full lips, and she looks like she's smiling. Almost keeping a secret. She's very reminiscent of the Mona Lisa.
Yeah.
I'm sure I'm not the first to observe that, but.
Yeah. So fast forward to 1955, and the Norwegian toy manufacturer, Asmund Lerdal, I hope I'm saying that
You said that perfectly.
Okay. Saves his son, Tor, from near drowning in a river. Shortly after, he is approached to design a mannequin to help teach cardiopulmonary resuscitation, CPR. He decides that a female mannequin would be less scary for students and wants her to have as natural a face as possible. Remembering a plaster cast of L'Inconnu, he decides to replicate her face. L'Inconnu is reborn as Recessa Annie.
As Lerdal themselves put it, quote, like Leonardo da Vinci's Mona Lisa, oh, here I got ahead of myself, and John Everett Millais' Ophelia, the girl from the Seine represents an ideal of beauty and innocence. Side note, the paramedics were trained to talk to the doll during the process, saying, Annie, are you okay? While they performed. This phrase ended up being used by Michael Jackson in his hit song, Smooth Criminal. So, Annie, are you okay, is referring to Recessa Annie, which is referring to the woman of the Seine.
Here's a little clip of the video.
That is fascinating to me. So before this, I did not realize that there was a name for that CPR doll. I did not realize that her name was Recessa Annie. And I never would have guessed in my life that that phrase from that song was a reference to this. That is so insightful. And this is one of the reasons I love doing this podcast with you. As a small aside.
Hey, I bring the noise, all right? So the unknown woman of the Seine is now the most kissed woman in the world.
Ew.
With paramedics learning how to give the kiss of life on her likeness every single day. There's something to be said of the romanticism of mostly men, before women became paramedics, reviving the drowned Ophelia of legend, which plays into the fantasy of the fragile young woman who takes her own life only to be rescued by the right and valiant man. Her problems can simply be mended with the right male intervention.
I believe that the medical description for that is actually called true love's kiss. I believe that's what Dr. Walter Disney established as that prescription. That prescriptive diagnosis. Look, I maintain you about that. I appreciate and respect the cause, the validity, the contribution to society and safety that the tool that is Recessa Annie has provided, or Recessa Anne perhaps has provided, that will not belay my response of ew to the idea of this woman whose last gasp was satisfaction in ending something that she never consented to in the first place, and then being made a tool and a prop for the rest of her non-existence. It just, it rubs me the wrong way.
Yeah.
And that's okay.
And again, this is why we're coming back to the way that female suffering is depicted and romanticized. It, you know, it becomes an object of fascination.
Yes.
You know, like we enjoy seeing women in pain.
In an episode of the Criminal podcast focusing on L'Inconnu de la Seine. Did I say it right? Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
The host, Phoebe Judge, as you mentioned previously, asks a guest how it was that the story of the unknown woman was so believable to so many, despite there being no evidence of her having existed. Her guest replied that the city was full of anonymous people and young women in tragic circumstances, and that it could easily have been anyone. Which is fair that it could have been anyone, but I mean, it's someone.
Well, I did bury the lead there, which is in a wonderful episode of Criminal. What Phoebe interviews a scholar that was really determined to find out, like, if she could figure out who it was.
Okay.
And so she's like going into the Paris archives, all the things, and she can't find any record of this person being pulled out of the river. Like she can't find it, like where it's supposed to be. And so then she tracks down like the house that did the plaster mask, which is a family business that still exists. Mm-hmm. And, you know, they would like use a mask and then mass reproduce it and then like get rid of the original. And then so like a copy of a copy of a mm-hmm. copy. And what she determined was that in all likelihood, the mask was made using a living model and that the story was created around the mask to sell it as an object of art. And so in all likelihood, the model probably existed, but was not, she was not polite. And the reason they say that is like the detail in the eyelashes, different things that when a body's been in water, it bloats, it disfigures. There's also an internal process that happens right. where as your body's decomposing, your organs basically implode. When the scholar tried to actually track down, because like maybe with like modern technology we could find the mask and we take the original cast and maybe there's DNA on it, like, you know, just like maybe there's a way, maybe we can find through looking. Now we have all this high powered technology that can help us sort through public records, right? Yeah. Like because of ancestry.com, things like that, like so many records got digitized. Maybe like with the power of all that computing we can come together and maybe narrow down. And what it came about was that in all likelihood, this person never existed.
Okay, you definitely buried the lead. It has been lost on me literally until this moment that this was all potentially apocryphal. And that honestly yeah. raises my spirits a little bit.
Well, I mean, yeah and no. While the scholars answer, you know, well, it was so believable because, you know, there were just so many young women coming into the cities and there was so much danger, especially from men. And if you look at the narrative that was developed around it, like, oh, she was pregnant. Oh, she was jilted by a lover. It tells you a lot about what people thought of women and the kinds of trouble that they would get into. Right.
Yeah.
And I think that's kind of a poetic answer and it's kind of simple. And I guess what I'm interested in is like, when people see a beautiful young woman, they see someone with limitless possibilities before her. So her death is a tragedy. What is more interesting and not discussed is how so many beautiful young women don't see the same thing. What are they trying to tell us about what beauty has done for them? And I think that's a little bit darker. But being young, a young, beautiful woman means you have the world by the tail. Then why are so many of them killing themselves? We're going to get into like how many do, and it's a problem, and it's a growing problem.
I think it presents it's not getting better. The question of, like, what is the difference between a martyr and an icon? Because I don't know in some ways. But luckily, we're right here and ready and raring to go for part three,
yeah.
which is about Eveleyn McHale. And the titular subject of this episode, I believe, the mm-hmm. most beautiful suicide.
Yes.
Which and so is a gripping. I was unaware. I'd probably seen this image, but never in the context that you've provided. And I just want you to know that the entire time that I've read any part of this text, this script, this anything, every time I'm confronted with this image of this beautiful woman who's completed suicide, it grips me in a very visceral way.
It's incredibly potent. It's a very potent image. It's on many lists, it's considered probably one of the most iconic photos ever taken.
Yeah.
Like one of the most important, I don't want to say iconic, one of the most important photos ever taken.
If anything that has ever qualified to appear in the annals of photographic history and also the annals of rotten.com can ever shake hands in unison, this yeah. image is the beautiful takeaway of that horrifying intersection.
Yeah.
Just to give some context to people. Because I don't yeah. want anybody to feel like they have to view any of these images to appreciate the takeaway. You don't have to see any of these images. I encourage you to. It is helpful, yeah. but you don't need to traumatize yourself for the sake of it.
So let's travel further ahead in time to May 1st, 1947. A young photographer named Robert Wiles was hanging out around the Empire State Building in New York City when there was a sudden, loud crash. People looked around bewildered until they saw that the roof of a parked limousine was completely caved in. There, wrapped in the metal and shattered glass, was the body of a young woman. She had thrown herself from the top of the building and landed neatly on the car, her legs crossed, a hand still clutching the pearls around her neck. She looked to be asleep, her body completely intact, her features and limbs perfectly preserved.
The young photographer quickly snapped a photo of the wreckage, complete with horrified strangers and police surrounding the vehicle. The photograph was published in Life magazine and gained significant attention, becoming a haunting and iconic image of its time. It was called the most beautiful suicide. The image has been referenced in countless artworks across multiple mediums, even being used as the beginning of the Taylor Swift video for Bad Blood just a few years ago, which obviously we have a TikTok. You know it used to be mad love, so take a look what you've
done, 'cause baby now we got bad blood. I think it's interesting the use of this image. This because in the video, you know, when she falls into the car, she falls through it and down into a medical lab where she's basically put back together with the power of all these other women.
Yeah.
Right. So it becomes this thing about women working together to build each other up and become these like incredibly empowered super assassins, right?
Right.
So it's kind of taking that narrative and it's sort of switching it around, right? Because you're watching her be built back up through the different strengths of these different assassins. So it's kind of taking this moment and then kind of reconstructing it, right? I never thought I would be doing a fucking deep dive about Taylor Swift videos, but like,
here the you know, we are. Look,
here we are.
The way
in this year of our Lord 2024.
The way that you get Angelina Jolie, I get Taylor Swift.
Yeah. Like, oh, I see it.
I've always felt a little bit of a kinship with her because we have kind of similar eyes and similar-ish crazy. And like, if I got a nose job, maybe like I could see it. But
well, you're both tall, thin blondes with kind of wavy blonde hair
and a penchant like, for shitty relationships.
Don't we all? I mean, that's like
I ain't special, JK.
Yeah. I feel like that comes standard with the uterus.
Oh, it's true. That's just a standard feature.
Yeah. While the photograph itself captured a moment of serene tragedy, it also raised discussions and debates about the ethics of publishing such images in the media. Some criticized the publication of McHale's photograph, arguing that it sensationalized and glamorized her death, potentially overlooking the underlying issues that led to her suicide, which were, of course, overlooked.
From Eveleyn McHale on Codex 99, quote, Eveleyn Frances McHale was born on September 20th, 1923 in Berkeley, California. She was the sixth of seven children. Eveleyn's family moved around the country a lot for that time period, and she endured an unstable family life. Her mother apparently suffered from depression, an illness that was likely not diagnosed, let alone treated, in the 1930s. This led to troubles with the marriage, and by 1940, Eveleyn's father was awarded custody of the minor children.
Which kind of tells you a lot, and I think I've said this before, but when a man seeks custody of his children, that's usually a sign that the mom was pretty Looney Tunes. Because it kind of takes a lot for men to take on that responsibility and for the court to decide that is the best place. Because the court, up until very recently, I mean, it was like, it was just a thing that the children were better off with their mother. Like, that's just the way it was. So the fact that at this time period that he was awarded full custody and that she let him have it, that means it was probably pretty bad.
Yeah, that time period especially.
I just want to point out that, like, these next few paragraphs, we're literally just reading the article from Codex 99 because the point is more the analysis. So I just want to be clear with that with people, because I was watching some videos. There's a lot of stuff going on around, like, plagiarism and giving appropriate credit with online content. And so I'm trying to be as transparent as possible when that's happening.
Yeah.
You don't read the article. It's linked in the notes. Like, I don't need to improve on what's here. This is more information. And, like, the point of this pod ultimately is always, like, analysis. All of this research, like, this was done by someone that did an amazing job. And I was like, let's just read the article because it's great.
As a librarian, this is literally all I can ever offer you. I can only ever offer you the research that I do of other people's great perspectives, and I can give you a modicum of my own analysis.
So the article goes on. She later joined the Women's Army Corps, where office machine operator was listed as her occupation. Apparently, military service didn't agree with her. It was reported that after her service, she burned her uniform.
Good for you, girl.
When she was 21, she met Barry Rhodes, an ex-Army navigator who was studying engineering under the GI Bill. They dated, became engaged, and planned a June 1947 wedding at Barry's brother's home in Troy, New York. I want to stop there. The burning of the uniform, I just feel like something happened there.
Yeah, that's burning anything. That is burning. When a woman burns something, the signifier to me is that she is burning that bridge. And that's almost always something that one does post-relationship. Yeah. And you do that to burn, like, their access to you, to your body, to your vulnerability.
Yeah, like something there.
You don't introduce fire to an equation because they shorted you on your last paycheck.
Yeah.
That's not how we do. A year before her death, she was a bridesmaid in her brother-in-law's wedding. After coming home from the event, she tore off her dress and said, "I never want to see this again." Barry, her fiancé, later told reporters that she worried for some silly reason because she was afraid she was not good enough to be my wife. "I thought I talked her out of that silly notion. She often voiced fears of not being a good wife. But when I kissed her goodbye, she was happy and as normal as any girl about to be married. I don't know what her last words to me were. She had to run for the train," he said. Eveleyn boarded the train back home to New York at 7 a.m. May 1st, 1947, and I do believe those were the last words he misheard from his fiance before her death.
So, yeah. So the tearing off the bridesmaid's dress, like, I clearly there was like an issue, like the constant, like, I'm not a good wife or I won't be a good wife. Like, that tells me that she didn't want to get married.
The role of wife was incredibly prescribed at that time.
Yes.
It was not just, okay, well, the next step of your relationship is now he put a ring on it. Good for you. It was, that was your role. That was your career, in fact, at the time. Like, being a wife was a job. Being a mother was a job. It still is. Yeah. We just don't afford it the same gravitas these days. But at that time, her marrying this man would have been her marrying into a role that she would have had to socially subsume.
Yeah. And I just feel like a lot was missed. Like that, and we're going to get into it in the next section, and that there's a reason why I chose to group these particular artworks in one place, because we're about to get into some the realities of what goes on in women's lives when they get to this place.
And I just want to acknowledge, I'm completely leaving on the table all of her silly, quote unquote, reasons and concerns. And silly is a word that we have really changed a lot over time. Silly has meant anything as recently as like ridiculous and absurd, like her silly reasoning. Back in the like hundreds of years ago, you could tell someone, oh, what a silly baby, and you'd be complimenting their child. So I just don't want anybody to be hearing this and think that I'm not like, or we are not jumping on the fact that he's calling her silly, quote unquote. Silly is a word that has meant a lot of things throughout the ages. So after
Eveleyn jumped and landed on the roof of the Cadillac parked on 34th Street, crowds began to assemble around the scene. Later, Detective Frank Murray found her coat neatly folded over the observation deck wall, a brown makeup kit filled with family pictures, and a black pocketbook with her suicide note, which read,
I don't want anyone in or out of my family to see any part of me. Could you destroy my body by cremation? I beg of you and my family, don't have any service for me or remembrance for me. My fiancé asked me to marry him in June. I don't think I would make a good wife for anybody. He's much better off without me. Tell my father I have too many of my mother's tendencies. And that was her suicide note.
The most beautiful suicide stands is a haunting portrayal of a tragic event, capturing a moment that juxtaposes beauty and destruction, evoking complex emotions and reflections on the human condition and the complexities of mental health struggles. The photograph continues to be studied and referenced in discussions about the ethics of media representation and the impact of such images on societal perceptions of suicide.
I had a prescribed notion of what it means to be a wife and what it means to be a mother for me when I was growing up, knowing that those were not roles that I was relegated to.
Yeah.
And even in that upbringing, when I thought about myself as simply a wife or simply a mother, without any of the other afforded sort of niceties of female identity pasted onto them.
Absolutely. So this brings us to what I really wanted to talk about, which is a study that was published called A Cross-Cultural Study of Female Suicide. Again, like everything else, will be linked down in the show notes, so you can read like the full study.
Well, this does in fact bring us to part four, morbidity versus mortality, a cross-cultural study of female suicide. These depictions of female suicides perpetuate the idea that female suffering can be portrayed as a haunting yet beautiful tragedy, emphasizing aesthetics over complexities of her honest pain. So let's look at the reality of female suicide. We are going to read from a cross-cultural study of suicidality in women, and the full text of this study will be linked in the show notes.
While suicide rates have historically been higher among men, The rate of suicide among women has been rising steadily over the past few decades. As of the latest available data, the suicide rate for females in the United States was around 5.8 per 100,000 individuals, according to the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. Suicide ranks as the number one cause of mortality in young girls between the ages of 15 and 19 years old globally. The rate of suicide in young women has seen a sharp incline, with mortality increasing as they are frequently choosing more fatal means to complete suicide.
One reason for the lack of investment in female suicidal behavior may be that there has been a tendency to view suicidal behavior in women as manipulative and non-serious, despite evidence of intent, lethality, and hospitalization. This gets my fucking goat.
Mm-hmm. And I just, so you guys know, this is the text from the study. This is not me editorializing.
Yes.
Like, this is in the study.
Quoting from the study, to describe their attempts as quote unquote unsuccessful, failed, or attention seeking, and generally to imply that women's suicidal behavior is inept or incompetent.
We can't even do that right.
A notable aspect of the way that our society discusses women's attempt to end their own lives. We are
also just in any medical setting, just that women aren't taken seriously.
Ever.
And the way that they're described, even in medical literature, using language that implies that they are inept or incompetent.
Yes. Yes.
It just grinds my gears. In general, marriage appears to be less protective against suicide for women than for men. This seems to be particularly the case for young women in developing countries in Asia. The life and marital circumstances of these women may make them vulnerable to suicidal behavior. Stresses may include arranged and early marriage, young motherhood, low social status, domestic violence, and economic dependence. Social, cultural, and religious constraints may discourage women from employment, careers, and financial and social independence, and encourage them to remain within unhappy marriages, independent living arrangements with extended family. So, turns out that marriage is actually, for many women, something that makes you more likely to want to commit suicide. So,
well, when we look
for men, it's the opposite. Men get married, it decreases their chances.
When men get married, when we look across cultures, it is most frequently a woman marrying into his family and moving into a household filled with his family. And she is now marrying into a support role for his family. So they are gaining a maid. He's gaining a bang maid. She's losing everything.
Yeah.
And this is not limited to any culture, any country, any society. This, we see it come hell or high water. We see it. It's a tale as old as time. I see it across social affluence, across intellectual ability, across race, across everything. This is the story of women.
Yes.
Depression is the most common risk factor for serious suicidal behavior in both men and women, and it occurs twice as often in women as in men. Oquendo et al. Studied a cohort of 314 patients with major depressive disorder and found that the risk factors for men were a family history of suicide, comorbid substance abuse, and early separation for men. For women, the risk factors were a previous suicide attempt, the lethality of that attempt, and lower number of reasons for living. So just to recap, for men, it was family history of suicide versus women's personal history of suicide. For men, comorbid substance abuse versus for women, just did you do it or not? When you tried, lethality, did you do it?
Lethality of the attempt, like how close she came to completing.
And then the last factor for men was a family history of suicide.
Was early history of separation.
Oh, and it's really hard to compare apples and oranges when your oranges are literally running out of reasons to stay alive.
Yeah. Women just have fewer reasons to live.
Yeah.
Globally, we just have fewer reasons to live.
Yeah.
Like that shit was so heavy on my heart when I read that. Women with anorexia are estimated to have a 50-fold increased risk of suicide. And suicide is the second leading cause of death in those with anorexia. Both bulimia and anorexia are linked with increased risk of suicide attempt, with suicide attempts reported in up to 20% of patients with anorexia and up to 35% of those with bulimia. Women with borderline personality disorder have a higher prevalence of suicidal behavior. They concluded that PTSD appears to be a particular strong predictor of suicide attempt.
Before I continue on with the script right now, I'm going to take a quick pause. Because if you're like me, you're seeing yourself in way too many of these statistics, and it's fucking with you, and it's hurting your feelings, and it's hurting your heart, and it's hurting a lot of you in a lot of ways. Let's just take a breath together. We all knew that this was a fucked up world. But also, this is not necessarily what we're saying is a reflection of a lot of statistics that are weighed differently across values, across spectrums, across analyses. If you're feeling overwhelmed right now, so the fuck am I. You're not alone, but it's okay to take a breath, to take a breather, to take a breath, to take a break. And also, it's important to remember that you don't need to let statistics impinge on your actual lived identity. The statistics of people like you are not the statistics of you personally. So if you're feeling a kind of way, I got you. So am I. It's fine. We'll be fine.
We're going to get through this together. And the thing is, we need to talk about it, because it's often like, well, women don't go through with it, so we don't need to worry about them. And it's like, if you've got a massive percentage of the population that is trying to kill themselves, like, that is a problem.
Yeah.
And we're going to get into the difference between suicide and suicidality.
Yes.
Because they get into it in the study. So we're about to kind of get to the way things are categorized and the conclusions of this study and what they felt needed to be done to address the problem.
Absolutely. Pregnancy usually has a protective effect against suicide. This protective effect during and after pregnancy may be reduced in mothers under the age of 20 or those in pregnancies that end in stillbirth or miscarriage. And if the pregnancy is unwanted, essentially, there's a protective effect when a woman is pregnant and wants to be. That's where
and is over the age of 20. I have a feeling a lot of those unwanted pregnancies and those under the age of 20 are most likely from rape or incest, because that's just the way it generally goes.
That is appropriately, unfortunately, correct. In those with postpartum psychosis, suicide risk increased sevenfold in the first year after childbirth, and 17-fold in the longer term.
I want us to do an episode just about postpartum depression, because people don't talk about it, but it's my understanding, and I may be wrong, so, you know, follow up, come correct with me. If postpartum is not treated, like, when it happens, right, it gets harder to get better. So then it's like it stays longer. And like that's, I think, why you see that increased suicidality if the postpartum depression goes on for like longer than a year after the baby's born. Like,
yeah,
because they're still learning about postpartum, you know, and exactly what's going on there and the mechanisms. You know, my mental health is still very much like, you know, like, yeah, we know there's a Mariana Trench. We know there's... We know the contours of the ocean floor, but we still really don't know a whole lot about what's going on there. And with a lot of mental health, specifically mental health conditions that impact women, just like also with autoimmune disorders, right? It's like there's still just so much we don't know about, you know, how it all works. But it's definitely that, like, if you are like, really what this thing is like, if you are depressed for more than a year, your chances of committing suicide go up.
Yeah.
Pretty rational. Like, you know.
Right. A lot of the understanding that we have, a lot of the psychology that we lack, honestly, about women in a postpartum depression situation, I think have to do with the fact that a lot of the women who are in the worst of those situations are not submitting themselves to psychiatric review and are also in relationships where even if they wanted to, they might not be able to. Because having, from what I understand, having a partner who does not encourage you to explore your own like health agency is also part of a contributor, is also a contributing factor to postpartum depression. Like having a partner who doesn't want you to follow up on your own health needs, to look into why you're feeling the way that you are. Like it's not an external thing. It's obviously you and you just need to be better. Like all of that kind of just piles on. But
it's almost like being a mom is not fun. Like I hate to say this, but studies have already shown the happiest cohort of people on the planet globally are women over 40 that have never married and never had children. Pregnancy, giving live birth, actually ages you on a cellular level by 10 years. Now, so that's just, and it is a trauma to your body. Birth is traumatic. Just because it's natural doesn't mean that it's not a trauma. It is a massive trauma to your body. Your whole body changes. It spreads your hips, your hip bones. Like it, like there's a lot of things that are going on with you physiologically that are drastically changing your body. Okay. That's the medical stuff. We're just learning what the emotional, psychological, hormonal stuff is. Now, on top of that, so major trauma to the body, the psychological impact of now having something that you are 100% responsible for, right? Now we're going to add into the mix whether or not you are getting support in taking care of the child from your husband, whether or not you're getting sleep, whether or not you're getting support in the workforce. What, like now you add on all the other stuff.
Even if your body is on the fast track to healing, postpartum healing, postpartum trauma, postpartum depression, which is a diagnosis, but is also on some level a symptom. Like there's just the blues of having an empty womb are not the same thing as being depressed. The same way that, you know, being kind of sad sometimes isn't the same thing as being, you know, depressed. But you've got all of these things and all of them are just considered part and parcel of just your duty of being this oven for humanity. And it's your duty. It's your gender's duty. It's your gender's job. And it's not just even if your partner doesn't buy into it, it's still like, well, you know, biology and everything. And well, you know, everyone and everything. It's like there's so many supporting factors.
Yeah. Well, there can also just be the depression. And I think that men don't go through this in the same way when they have a child because, they're also responsible for it. But when you're nursing something, right? Like it needs you to live.
Yeah.
Like that can be really psychologically alienating because you've never been that before.
Your body's like insertion into the process matters.
Yeah. Like you physically are required.
Yeah.
Like you are required. And that can be, I would imagine that's like a lot to deal with psychologically. Before you even get into the social stuff of like now you're in this role of mother. So you've moved into a different social role, which in and of itself is like psychologically intense. But when you've got it like on a biological level, like if I'm not like it won't survive without me, like I have to do this. Men don't have the same thing.
Right.
So they're not going to go through that same physical thing. Like I remember overhearing a mother talking to her son because we were in an airport and a baby was crying. Mm-hmm. And
Gates McFadden.
And that woman was Gates McFadden, but she didn't, I didn't say, oh my God, you're Gates McFadden. I was just like sleeping next to her in a Paris airport. Anyway, her son was young and a woman in the terminal had a baby that was crying. And her son was not being fussy, but he was kind of like, oh, that baby. She was like, listen, that mom is like whatever anxiety you're feeling right now, she's feeling it twice as much. When a woman has a baby, there's something in her that when she hears a baby cry, it triggers a panic in her. I'm paraphrasing. She was explaining this to her son. God, that was such a like what a weird like. And it was Gates McFadden, Dr. Crusher from Star Trek: The Next Generation.
He's the coolest ever. Yeah.
And I was like, man, that she's like a cool mom. The way she's talking to her kid, like he's a grown up.
We need to snip that and tag her in it.
Yeah. For some young women, abortion is a traumatic life event that increases vulnerability to suicidal behavior. And I've noted that they're being very careful around the language they use here, but it's time to call a spade a spade. Rates of suicidal ideation and mental health problems, including depression, anxiety, and substance use disorders, are increased among women who have had induced abortions. An emerging issue is that women with fertility problems who are not able to conceive after treatment also have a higher risk of suicide. So, the study found that abortion does lead to increased suicide, depression, anxiety, and substance use disorders. And I am still pro-choice because people need choices and they need options. But I want to be intellectually honest and like not cut that paragraph out.
Well, how many of the women who got abortions, who then experienced some really fucked up feelings about those abortions, were completely comfortable with their decision when they made it until they had to walk through clinic after clinic and parking lot after parking lot full of women and men and people yelling at them? And the men are bad because the men feel violent, but the women are bad because the women feel too relatable. Yelling at you about what a piece of of a human you are and actively trying to talk you out of something that they will simply not be available for tomorrow. They really have a big opinion about something that will not impact them tomorrow. And I wonder how much of that has to do with things. And
well, it also doesn't like people generally are getting abortions because they need them.
Yeah.
Because they need one, right?
Yeah. It's not for fun. It's not for the experience.
It's not for fun.
It's not skydiving. So
generally, when you're dealing with an unwanted pregnancy, it doesn't go into where these people that came from super religious households were they also victims of incest or sexual assault, which is why they were seeking the abortion. Like, was it the abortion that was increasing these things, or was it the reasons they needed the abortion what was causing these problems? That is something that is not explored in the paper because that was not the mandate of the research they were doing.
Right.
That's not the point. It was compiled as a global study on female suicide. That's the focus. It's just like, what are the factors that do this? So like, I'm sure other people have done that work, but so I just wanted to couch it with this was not the scope of the study to go in there and figure all of that, those factors out. They were kind of trying to look at outward factors, because it's a lot harder to say someone's religious trauma started a chain reaction of events where then they were molested by their youth pastor, where then they got pregnant and then they had to get in a, you know what I mean? Like they're not following back the chain of events.
Childhood adversities, including physical, emotional, and sexual abuse, lead to substantially higher risk for suicide. Wife abuse is one of the most significant precipitants of female suicide. Research suggests that if a woman's support group does not defend her when she is the victim of violence that passes the bounds of normative behavior, her suicide may be revenge suicide, intended to force others to take vengeance on the abusive husband. Abused, shamed, and powerless, wives take their own lives to shift the burden of humiliation from themselves to their tormentors.
So, saying beyond the bounds of normative behavior, I just want to remind you guys, this is like a cross-cultural study. So there may be things that are considered permissive and normal in some cultures that we might consider beyond the bounds. So they're contextualizing it like, if it's like within your own culture, like it has extended into something that's beyond what is considered normal.
Right.
So I just wanted to kind of clarify that language a little bit, because I know that you know, we can tend to be very like culturally myopic, you know, when we're discussing things. But so just to remind you guys, we're talking about a cross-cultural study.
Right.
So, you know, that in and of itself is kind of a monumental task. So unique cultural factors can also contribute to spousal abuse. In China, for instance, the government policy of a one-child norm has led to enormous pressure on wives to give birth to the highly preferred male child. On failing, which women, especially in rural China, are not infrequently mistreated, harassed, or divorced. The preference for the male child and the ill treatment of the mother who gives birth to a female child is also seen in India. The prevalence of this desire for a male child is seen across the entire country, as well as all sections of Indian society.
Which is especially fucked up if you know that genetically it is the male
who determines the sex of the child. Yeah.
Yeah. Another distinctive form of abuse in Indian society is associated with dowry and dowry disputes. In India, dowries are a continuing series of gifts endowed before and after the marriage. When dowry expectations are not met, the young bride may be killed or compelled to commit suicide, most frequently by burning. Suicide by burning amongst women is a major concern in India, as it has become pervasive throughout all social strata and geographical areas. Jesus. Suicide by burning is, man, people love to say that women just don't like to take violent attempts at suicide. We just want to poison ourselves and look pretty. Oh, suicide by burning is counterintuitive to every argument that poses that idea.
Exposure to childhood sexual abuse is more common among females and increases vulnerability to subsequent psychopathology and to adverse life events, both associated with increased risk of suicidal behavior. The risk of both suicidal ideation and suicide attempt increases with the extent of sexual abuse. Siegel found that sexual coercion and rape limits one's later reasons for not committing suicide.
Experiencing hunger was associated with over sixfold increases in the odds of attempting suicide. Young age at marriage increased the risk sixfold as well, while exposure to violence was associated with a sevenfold increase. Jesus.
So, okay. Global evidence challenges widespread assumptions about women and suicidal behavior. One such assumption is based on Durkheim's theory that women are immune from suicide as long as they remain quote unquote feminine, family bound, and socially subordinate. There is evidence contrary to this theory. Actually, social equality protects women from suicide, especially among the young. A recent study of 33 developing and industrialized countries found that women's suicide rates were lower in countries with social structures emphasizing social equality.
The main obstacle to the prevention of suicidal behavior in women is the belief that suicide is a male problem, and an overemphasis on individual factors in addition to the underappreciation of social, economic, and cultural factors in female suicidal behavior. It is further compounded, on top of all of that, by the fact that there is lack of women-specific research on suicide and most health things. We just don't care about women. Significant progress in the prevention of female suicidal behavior may require a paradigm shift of focus to ecological factors in addition to individual factors.
There it is.
It's really complicated, it's really hard, and we just don't care enough to understand the nuances.
Yeah, well, like summarized, what they're saying is that women's social position under patriarchy are so shitty that they have fewer reasons to live.
Yeah, like why would you? If you had to walk a mile in our shoes.
Education, economic security, and an empowerment of women should be an integral part of suicide prevention strategy. Strict enforcement of the prohibition of forced marriages, dowry, and child marriage in countries where they are prevalent is important. Reduction of intimate partner violence will reduce suicidality in women. In the absence of sexual abuse, the female suicide attempt rate over a lifetime would fall by 28%.
Additional strategies would be to reduce media portrayal of women dying by suicide due to interpersonal conflicts and to enhance women's ability to cope with interpersonal and intergenerational conflicts, especially in areas where interpersonal and intergenerational conflicts directly inflict with their ability to live their day-to-day life with their partner and their family. Reducing suicidal behavior in women should be a public and social objective rather than just a niche traditional exercise in the mental health sector. This should be something that we all care about and we are all invested in.
If you remove the conditions that make women suicidal, that's going to be better than inpatient kind of treatment. Right. Like, you can treat a suicidal patient all you want. If they're in these circumstances that, like, are inescapable, it's not going to be very effective, no matter what the therapy is, you know? And so but in order to start changing those things, there has to be public awareness that, like, hey, child marriage has, like, a deleterious impact.
Understanding how to convey information to people in a way that they are primed to receive it, understanding a community enough to know how to share with them the information in a way that they will be able to parse it is a skill. And then also recognizing the way that certain information will impact those communities and the way to present it to them so that they understand that impact and can perceive it within the realm of how their community subsists. Those are all really important things about being an information professional, about being somebody who cares about other people. Like, you have to meet people where they're at. You can't expect people to be on your sociological PhD level when you're walking into a community that doesn't know what any of that shit is. Like,
well, and you also have to divest yourself of patriarchy. You have to divest yourself of white supremacy. Like, if that is your identity, like, you have to kind of it's all about de-investing from these structures so that you can walk into communities actually trying to serve them instead of yourself. And so it's about approaching problems like suicide.
We've already explored that with the BPD episode, where a lot of the psychiatrists, a lot of the psychological analysts and professionals only see these patients literally on the worst possible day they could ever be seen. And so they're getting a comprehensive diagnosis based on the singular worst day that you could ever observe them. And so we have some comprehension of that.
What really started things was, you know, like when Simone de Beauvoir wrote, like, The Second Sex, right? It's like when women started just talking about their experiences, and then people started to realize, like, oh, people aren't happy. Like, this is actually making people desperately unhappy, right? It's by going in and talking to the people that are in it.
Right. That is something that is actively being debated in states right now.
Yeah.
And like, not just in terms of, like, oh my gosh, abortion, but Oklahoma's got some serious conversations going on about no fault divorce, which is basically just being able to get divorced because this sucks, basically.
Yeah.
The more female independence we see in the workplace, the more women we see getting custody of their children, the more women we see thriving financially, the more women we see remaining single or remaining divorced and not remarrying well into adulthood, the more we see that, the more we see conservative voices lashing out against the rights and liberties that permit women to be in positions where we don't have to be dependent on men. As wives, as mothers, we don't have to marry into a happy life. We can just provide that for ourselves if we want. The more we see women thriving and taking independence in our back pocket, the more we see loud, angry conservative voices, mostly from Republican men, who want to take away those rights. And if I don't say that out loud, then when I am inevitably deprived of them, because I am a
young
Texan
woman in Texas. I don't even tell my doctor. When was my period? I don't know. Crazy. I'm sure it happened. It's like the tooth fairy.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm an adult woman and I can't tell my own doctor the nuances of my menses for my own safety. That's where I live right now. That is the future of AI and cool technology. I'm the queen of VR porn, but I can't tell my own doctor when I menstruate, just in case.
Housekeeping. Let's do some housekeeping.
Yes.
We have a Patreon. We have a $5 tier. It's our only tier right now. We're treating it kind of like a tip jar, but you get uncensored video of the podcast. You get show notes and you get bonus content, which will be like extra episodes that we do. And we are going to have that in the next like week or two is when we will start dropping bonus content on the Patreon. So if you would like to support, if you can support, if that feels good to you, the link is in the show notes and you can go sign up and say hi. And as we get our workflow going more smoothly, we'll be able to offer more extras and more tiers and do things like that. And we're also setting up a Discord. So if you join the Patreon, then you can join the Discord and chat with each other, chat with us, have all the funs. So that's a business.
Keep an eye out on that. at the current juncture, it really is just like, you're like the top besties. We would never put out any crucial information that we feel like we've done a lot of research into. We would never deprive the public, our public fans, of that information.
Yeah.
So I just want people to rest assured that like you don't need to pay money to get the benefit of our academia.
Yeah.
You do need to be
free.
Pay money.
The podcast is still free.
pay money to be burdened with the weight of our personal bullshit. You'll have to get to know us. You'll have to learn our nuances. And like, pet names that I use for this bitch over here, they're money.
Listen, I'm a fan of podcasts. I listen to podcasts and I hate it when the entire podcast is advertising for Patreon or something. Like, I get it, but like, we're not going to do that here. Like, you're going to get quality bonus content. I just want to say, like, I know the path that podcasts go down and like, that's not happening here. So you're still getting super quality content in the feed. You will get at least one bonus episode per month. You might get more, but you'll always get one.
Yes.
So, and just like, we'll always be here on Monday. Sometimes like last week, it might be a little late on Monday, but we've really priding ourselves on that. Like, we're always here for you when you expect us to be here. And the content is always as good as we can make it. In the show notes, there will be links to all of Ella's socials. There'll be links to all of my socials and contact info for the show. If you want to email us and give us notes or compliments or any of it. And also, please, 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 if you are listening to the podcast right now and you have never just gone on your app and pushed the 5-star rating, please do that.
Oh my God.
Just please, please give us a rating. If you have it in you to give a review, please do that. I can't explain exactly how, but that feeds into the algorithm that determines whether or not we chart, and charting is kind of the main way that the podcast becomes visible to new subscribers. And obviously we would like to have as many subscribers as possible because, you know, we feel like what we're doing here is important. And
I've got it. Charting for a new podcast is like squirting for a new cam girl. As soon as you realize you can do it, you're like, oh my God, how have I not been doing this the entire time? Are you sure that this is legit and that I'm not just pissing all over everybody? I don't know, but I sure hope they like it if I'm doing it.
Well, you know, I used to never do it for podcasts because I didn't know it mattered. I really didn't. I was like, oh, who cares, right? Like, Once it was explained to me that it actually helps them to become visible because there's a magical algorithm that figures everything out.
I make a point
for any podcast that I listen to more than one episode, I just go and hit a 5-star rating because I know that it helps. So, and my manager was like, you need to be telling people I keep forgetting.
Actually, I can't make any promises. Tell you what, once I finally make my return to OnlyFans, which I swear to God is coming any week now, I will return to my promise where if you post a review and you send me a screenshot of that review, I will send you, I don't know, something. I didn't think it out thoroughly, but I'm sure it will make you smile. A wink, wink, a nudge, nudge. In the bikini.
I don't know.
Zone.
Can you rate on Spotify?
I'm not certain. I think
you can.
No,
you can't do reviews. I don't think, but you can rate.
So, yeah, you might be able to just click a.
But we had kind of a viral moment like 2 weeks ago, and got a bunch of new subs and
welcome new subs.
And we actually charted in the top 50 for history on Spotify, which was really cool. We entered the charts at 41, which is amazing because they only go to 50. Like they don't do, Apple goes to 200. But then we also, on Apple, we got up into the top 50 on Apple as well. It was really cool.
Thank you all for liking us.
Thank you for all of the people that subscribed and hit that follow button on their podcast.
Thanks for smashing the JSON.
Smash that like button.
Thanks for picking the JavaScript as hard as you can. I don't know.
Credits. I don't necessarily want to say that I wrote this episode. I feel more like saying I compiled, because we did kind of just read at you a study and read at you an article. But script by me, Sovereign Syre, hosted by me, Sovereign Syre, Miss Ella Darling, and produced by Mr. Joshua Anderson. And yeah.
That's all we got. Thanks for button with us.
Yeah. And we actually are going to have a really important Native American scholar on the podcast soon. That's right. Our first guest is coming. I don't want to jinx it by saying who it is in case anything changes. But as it currently stands,
I feel like our third host is finally joining us. And I do not mean Susie, whom I do love and adore, which, by the way, you old school fans of the pod, I got to see Susie at XBiz this past week or two ago. And I got a big hug from her. And she is a big fan of what we're doing with the pod. And I'm so grateful that she gave her blessing for me to step into her very glamorous red bottom shoes on this show.
Yes.
So
yes,
it's a little love. Little love. Thank you, Sabaran.
Thank you.
Thank you. All
right, we did it.
We did it.
I am coming to you from the traditional land of the Tongva and the Chumash, out here in East LA in California. And just wanted to acknowledge the original stewards of the land. And
Fuck yeah. And Mr. Catterson and I, if you are not on the video, I have a small cat in my hands. Cat and I are coming at you from Austin, Texas, which is the historical land of the Tonkawa, Lipan Apache, and Comanche peoples. And we have much gratitude for the original stewards and defenders of this land.